how do we get infected with the coronavirus? Japanese researchers have used a supercomputer to simulate how viral particles move. Their findings show how far even the smallest droplets can spread, and how masks, social distancing and humidity impact the spread of COVID-19. Their research suggests that the use of humidifiers may help limit infections indoors during times when regular ventilation isn't possible. Until vaccines are widely available, doctors suggest sticking to the three W's. Watch your distance, wash your hands, and wear a mask. The simulation makes the invisible threat visible and could help people to evaluate risk of infection. This is DW's COVID-19 special. I'm Kate Ferguson. Thanks for joining me. The United Kingdom has become the first country in the world to approve a coronavirus vaccine developed by Germany's BioNTech and US pharma giant Pfizer. British regulatory authorities say the jab can be delivered in the coming days. The vaccine, which has been found to be 95% effective in trials, uses mRNA technology to train the body to create antibodies against the disease. But until a vaccine is rolled out around the world, the usual rules, wash your hands, keep your distance, wear a mask, remain the only way to guard against the virus. Here in Europe, many countries are still struggling to deal with surging infection numbers. In Spain, a nighttime curfew is in place across the country. But as DW reporter Jan Philip Scholz discovered, not everyone is sticking to the rules.
Every weekend, Madrid police have been knocking on hundreds of doors to shut down illegal parties. Madrid allows meetings of up to 6 people who are not related, but police have broken up parties of more than 200. Joaquin is a business student in Madrid. He only wants to speak briefly and anonymously, as he regularly goes to such parties. He himself recently helped organize one. We just rented a place so we could drink and smoke inside. A few visitors even wore masks, but that didn't last long. Honestly, young people's biggest fear is having to pay a fine. That's why the places need to be well insulated, so the neighbors and the police won't detect anything. Joaquin and his friends seem unfazed by the statistics. A third of Spaniards become infected with the coronavirus at private parties. Police Chief Javier Fernandez is especially troubled by the new business model being developed here. Bars that are actually supposed to be closed certainly do take money in exchange for letting people in. There's a clear economic incentive for it. Apart from that, we have discovered private homes that were charging entrance fees right at the front door. This isn't just about a few friends meeting up. Psychiatrist Diego Figuera is calling for more empathy with the young people, even if he supports strictly abiding by the hygiene measures. Experts are starting to acknowledge the consequences of such drastic restrictions on young people's social lives. Right now, we are finding out that young people's mental health problems have increased dramatically as a result of this spring's lockdown. Suicides have increased by 22% so far, and attempted suicides have even increased by 35%. On top of that, there's been a major increase in the consumption of alcohol and psychoactive drugs. Young Spaniards are now confronted with new rules. All bars in Madrid must close at 11 p.m. and curfew begins at midnight.
Half a year of the pandemic has massively affected the quality of life of young people all over the world. At the same time, experts keep emphasizing how dangerous partying can be in the current situation. Spain's chief epidemiologist even directly turned to Spain's youth and asked them to refrain from parties at the moment.
Even so, business student Joaquin doesn't want to be forbidden from partying. He says he can decide for himself what risk he's willing to tolerate, even if it means partying in private homes until 6 a.m. for the duration of the curfew.
Let's bring in Professor Lydia Morawska from the Science and Engineering Faculty at the Queensland University of Technology in Brisbane. Professor Morawska, welcome to the show. You've been warning about the dangers of airborne transmission of COVID-19 for months now. How does it make you feel to hear the young man in the report we just saw say he simply doesn't want to be forbidden from partying.
Something which I can't really understand, that at this stage of pandemic, someone can say something like this. Of course, the person can individually take a risk and say, I'm going to be infected, it's my business, but it's not. It's really a civil responsibility to consider this. If you are infected and you are going to go around and infecting others who potentially can die because of this, it's not just your personal issue.
Now, at the beginning of the pandemic, the prevailing advice was just wash your hands and keep your distance. But you were among those early on who recognised that this may not be enough to prevent infection. What's the latest research telling us?
Everybody's asking about the latest research about this. This is not about what was just discovered. It is something which we knew, I mean scientists, for a long time. And since SARS-1, we've been warning that something needs to be done in terms of proper recommendations and proper recognition of the risk of airborne transmission. And it's not just COVID, not just this pandemic, but all respiratory infections are transmitted this way. Somehow, no one was interested to listen, neither in Australia nor internationally. So when this pandemic came, we really put all our efforts to bring this mode of transmission into full focus.
And we're certainly listening now. Let's talk specifically about distance. We've been told to stay 1.5 to 2 metres away from each other. But these small airborne particles, they can travel much further than that, can't they?
Well, of course. If you are close to somebody, somebody who is infectious and somebody who is a source of these small particles, smaller, bigger particles, of course, in the proximity to that person, you are likely to inhale a lot and particles of all sizes, smaller, bigger. Bigger particles will potentially drop on the ground if they are big enough, but the smaller one will stay in the air, will linger in the air. Like, think about smells, cigarette smell, smell of something else lingers in the air. The particles from cigarette smoke are smaller than the particles with the virus, but nevertheless, the virus particles can stay in the air for a long time and travel long distances. So it's not enough to be away that meter and a half from somebody infected. It can be meters, tens of meters, or even hundreds of meters away from the infected person where the virus-laden particles linger in the air and can be inhaled.
And smells are really a perfect way to explain how this works. Now, people who oppose strict coronavirus measures argue that everything in life involves taking a risk. How do you personally weigh up the odds of being infected versus, say, the need to maintain social contacts and a relationship with the outside world?
This is true that everything involves risks, but the risks in getting infected, being in a place where people are infected, are very high. And I often say, for example, if this kind of risks were related to car travel, would you jump into the car if you had a risk of having an accident of a few percent? You'd think about this twice. This can be compared to the risks which we are taking or not taking. So weighing a risk is a particular risk which you don't quite understand, can't quite quantify. You really have to take all possible precautions to avoid taking this risk.
And I certainly wouldn't jump into that car. Professor Morosca from the University of Technology in Brisbane, thank you so much for your expertise.
Thank you for having me on the programme.
Time now to answer one of your questions about the coronavirus. Over to our science correspondent, Derek Williams.
What's the expected protection period for new mRNA vaccines? How long does it need to be for herd immunity?
We don't yet know how long these new vaccines will protect people who receive them because not enough time has passed since large numbers of people have received them. Trials have only been going on since the end of July. We know that when you catch other coronaviruses, it provokes an immune response that lasts for anything from months to a year or two. But we've never developed vaccines for those coronaviruses. So we don't really have anything to compare these new vaccines to, or a yardstick for guessing how long they might provide protection. Add to that the fact that if they do receive emergency use authorizations, then it'll be the first time that mRNA vaccines have ever seen widespread use. And it all becomes even more of a guessing game. But almost all the experts I read do say they don't expect them to provide lifetime protection. The question of how long the period of protection needs to be to provide herd immunity is trickier, because it could easily turn into a moving target. And most estimates you read say we should have the situation under control when 60 to 70% of the population acquires immunity through vaccination or sickness. If one or more vaccines provoke long-lasting immunity to COVID-19, say 10 years, that would be fantastic, basically because it would give us the time we need to vaccinate large chunks of the population and trust that they wouldn't be in danger again for a good long while. But if vaccine-provoked immunity is much shorter, say just 6 months or a year, it makes the logistics of large-scale vaccination programs a lot harder, because in addition to trying to get everyone their first shot, we'd have to also start giving people who'd gotten that booster shots in pretty short order. So a lot will hinge on the question of how long the various vaccine candidates protect people.